Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Prince, sati does not mean mindfulness. Since mind is not full, when aware, it is rather stilled into a precise, unique, one-pointed focus. Sati is thus much better translated as awareness or presence, which is one of the five spiritual abilities, indriya, and one of the five spiritual powers, bala. This core mental quality is also one of the seven factors of enlightenment, puyanga, and the seven method of the Noble Eightfold Way, magga. And it is in its widest sense one of those mental factors inseparably associated with all karmically advantageous kusala and karma produce lofty and beautiful subhana kinds of consciousness. It is continuously established by the four foundations of awareness, satipatthana. The blessed Buddha once said, "Friends, this is the only direct way to the mental purifications of beings, to the overcoming and elimination of all sorrow, frustration, pain and misery, to gaining the right method, to the realization of Nibbana, that is, the establishing of exactly these four foundations of awareness, these four frames of reference. One, being aware of the body only as a transient form. Two, being aware of the feeling just as a reactive response. Three, being aware of the mind merely as a passing set of moods. Four, being aware of any phenomena solely as a mental state." That is the four foundations of awareness. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends. This is indeed Dhamma on Air number 95. Closing in on the first 100, not too bad. On a windy day under the cypress tree in March 2018. There are three questions, two advertisements, but first, as usual, the crucial intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. First, regarding the old Buddha Direct group that had 7,000 members, went down. To those who see this video and doesn't get the email, go to what Buddha said, Buddha Direct Google group 2. I give the link below and in the video, and click subscribe to resubscribe, or send me an email and I subscribe you, so you keep being reminded of the Dhamma. reminded, which is a good thing, because this repeat, reiteration, makes a comprehension of the Dhamma both deeper, broader, more waste, and thereby more effective. Those who want to take it, I would say something like 17 steps further to a whole new level, can participate in one of the two meditation courses I conduct here in 2018. One is a meditation course here in Kandy in June. You can go to What Buddha Said. I'll give the link below for the program, or send me an email. And the other one is in late December in North Carolina, USA. Both of them will be extensive, thorough, and blissful in all regards. So, so much for that. Question 282. Humans are part of the animal kingdom and the most destructive animal on earth. Why is that so? Yes, animal kingdom, there's different classifications, of course, among different cultures and different knowledge fields. Animal kingdom sounds like a very old classification scheme from the early science era, and maybe also from a child game. Seen from a Buddhist perspective, then there are 31 levels of existence. I'll give a link below to the video I made specifically about explaining these 31 levels of existence, and I'll show the link up here, the 31 levels of existence. And there, humans are level 5, a fairly modest level. And if you look at this pancake structure of three levels, Kamaloka, where all beings say run after sense pleasure, and then Brahmaloka, where they are meditators and made of another material, very fine material level, and then Arupaloka, where they are basically formless, then this destructive behavior, evil karma, is only found in the lowest third, 11 levels, the Kamaloka, where we are level 5. And there, we are by no means less destructive than the animals. The animals have much more cruel traits than humans have, insofar as all those who are called predators, they eat other animals alive. And this is rare to see. Is there any instance of humans eating animals alive? I guess there is, but very few. It's not a normal trait. So they are very destructive also. Our destructive of other beings is often, for example, pollution, and making wars and so on, and the dropout of wars and making poisons. Often this destruction is unintentional, inadvertently, something that we are too stupid to realize will happen in the future because of doing this and that. Usually out of either greed, hate, ignorance, or fear. Do humans do bad? But animals can also do very evil. Among those, eat themselves. Cannibalism is common among animals, and is more and more common the lower you come in the animal kingdom. Crabs will eat each other alive. And this also goes for certain rats, so it's seen among mammals. But as far as I know, not among human beings. There has been cannibalism in the human society, and there will be again when there's no Buddha present here, along with common incest among human beings. But nevertheless, once you see these things, this self-destruction and other destruction and pollution of future, not as beings, because there are no beings in there. There are no actors, there are no agents, goes the saying in Buddhism. There's action, there's behavior. Behavior, but there's no actor. There's no agent. There's no controller. There's influences. And these influences can very well be characterized and grouped under these three headings of either greed, hate, or ignorance, or mixtures of them. If you take, for example, one thing that is a mixture of all three would be a state called jealousy or envy. There's greed for something, others' attention or a thing, and then there's hate towards those who have this attention or thing. And it's both because of ignorance of the fallible truth. So it is mental qualities or properties or pollutions that are destructive, not beings, because there are no beings. There are no actors. There are no agents. Another good expression to pick up from early Buddhism is there's this, we say, this samsaric round where you go from birth through a life and then back to to death and then to rebirth again. And this seems as this cycle is endless. The round of rebirth is called. But in the commentaries, then we look at it from an impersonal point of view and say, what is it that going around? This is the kilesas, the mental defilements. Greed, hate, ignorance, fear, jealousy, envy, stubbornness, rigidity, laziness, distractedness, and so forth. The row of kilesas, or the list of kilesas is long, something like 28, that are creative, influential forces that goes around in this circle. This is called kilesa vata. So it's a round of mental impurities that goes around in this samsaric round, not beings. There are no beings there in the first place. There are only these mental properties, qualities, or fermentations and pollutions. That is what is active in the first place. That is what is effective in the first place. Dhammapada 1, remember this, mind comes first. Mind is of all states the primer. Mind is of all phenomena the initiator. Mind is the maker and creator of this so-called reality and in any future reality also, whether individual or collective. So is this refocusing on mind, and which is a crucial first step in starting Buddhist training, because then it becomes evident through and through, self-evident, obvious, that the job then is to purify this mind, and that this is the only way to happiness, both here, now, and later. And furthermore, that this is the only way to deathlessness, and thereby that this is the only way, ikkayana, makko, one vehicle, one way, one unidirectional, irreversible way to the end of suffering, irreversible end of suffering. So there, animals and humans are more or less on the same beings. And it's also a very dynamic thing. There are no animals that are always evil, nor are there any humans that are always evil, nor are there any humans that are always good. So it's fluctuating from moment to moment how much influenced one is by anger or by greed or by ignorance or by lust or by desire or by doubt or by skepsis or by uncertainty, hesitation, jealousy, and so forth. It fluctuates up and down. It's momentary. Inside this momentary states of one step forward and two steps backward. You can say creating something and then destroying something, creating something and then destroying something. Which is basically what most beings do, of course, without, unfortunately, being aware of what they are doing. Seen from that, then there are not much difference between all beings, because they are in this samsara. Yes, it's true, which if we go higher than level 12, then they are good meditators. But one story illustrates that their kilesas, their mental defilement, is not over. The story goes like this. It's about the Bodhisattva Siddhartha Gautama Bodhisattva. Before he's become a Buddha, he told of one of his former lives. It's a Jataka story. It's a story from one of the 547 stories that we still have intact about what he told about his former lives. And this he told, that he was once a prince that was born but was very disinterested in life, and he sat inside a cupboard, meditated all day long, because he has come from the Brahma level. He's fallen from the Brahma level down to the human level. And since they are all meditators there, they spent their entire life without any even single moment of anger in the first jhana and upwards. And he has fallen down to human level from that high state. So he was used to being in this absorption, this meditative state. And that's why he caved in almost autistic manner inside this cupboard and wouldn't talk with anybody. And his mother and father, who was a king and queen, they were very unhappy. So they put forth a price and said, anyone who can get them out of his cupboard, they will get, if it's a female, then she will get to marry him and she will get half the kingdom. And then one female volunteered, a very beautiful one, and said, I can do it because I can sing in a way that no man can resist. And put me outside his door when you serve in his food. He got food every day, in through the door and in through the cupboard door by a waiter. And so after a couple of weeks, the Bodhisattva sitting inside his cupboard, he asked, who's this voice? And then he said, she can come in and stand outside the cupboard, not come inside the cupboard, but outside the cupboard. Eventually, he fell in love with her and had sex with her both inside the cupboard and outside the cupboard. Then they told him that there were many other men outside in this kingdom. And then out of rage, even though he has spent at least minimum at this Brahma level, minimum 75, no, sorry, what's a quarter of 150? 37, something like that. In the order of 37 a billion years in a meditative state, then his mental defilement was by no means eradicated. He got lost first by this passion of hearing this female voice, which overcome all males, and vice versa, with the male voice overcome all females. And same thing with the forms, taste, touch, and so on. So he was overcome by this auditory stimuli. It raised up his desire. When his desire came up, then also the hate towards his competitor, potential rivals, came up. So he grabbed his sword and ran down on the street and started chopping on everybody, because he wants to kill all other males that were his potential rivals for this woman he just has fallen in love with. So even after this, let's say 40 billion years of meditation on the Brahma level, then he came down here, and well, okay, he spent 16, 18 years in a cupboard, but then a situation so occurred that it re-stimulated his greed and hate. And eventually his mother and father admitted he's basically crazy, so they chased him out the kingdom. So this means that also the beings at the Brahma level have also greed and hate. It is latent. Same thing is in babies and in young children. There's still greed and hate, but their mind is weak, so you cannot see it. It is there, it will manifest itself. It is not eradicated, by no means. At the foremost levels, these endless consciousnesses that they can perceive several galaxies at one time and all the details at atomic scale, what's going on in these galaxies simultaneously. Still there's ignorance, some level of ignorance of the Four Noble Truths in these beings. So I don't agree. First of all, humans are not a part of the animal kingdom. Humans are a level above the animal kingdom. And we have much behavior that building hospitals, roads, schools, making music, culture, Buddhist videos, and so forth, that you don't see in the animal kingdom. Yes, it is true, we are both the self-destructive and other destructive at times and at an astronomical scale. The only cure is Buddhist training, ethics and discipline. Neither more nor less. And that's why I sit here, day after day, year after year, until I breathe out. So, most destructive animal is not the most destructive. Why are one destructive in general at all levels? Because of greed, hate, and ignorance. And if we should take one more aboard, which usually we say in the monastic society is creation of destructive things, then it is fear. One is afraid of this or that, that this will happen, they will discover this and that, see this and that, and this. Then one covers up, makes another lie. One is afraid this will happen, then one do something evil in order to prevent it, and then make something even more happen down the road, and so on. Ignorance is the deepest root. Right after there come greed and hate arise simultaneously, and they also go away simultaneously. Right after greed and hate arise comes fear. Fear of losing. Fear of the others reprehending one's mistakes. Question 283. Should we use foreign flowers if we want to show respect in a pagoda or a temple to Buddha statues or relics? Or if I'm practicing Satipatthana, is that good enough? Well, traditionally, one doesn't use foreign flowers. There is a pendant for it for us monks because we're not allowed to chop off wood like this tree that is standing up because there's beings living inside it. And this also goes for all flowers. The flowers themselves are not conscious, but all plant life, down to grasses, they contain conscious beings that can't be hurt if one cuts the plants down. So one should realize that neither being vegetarian or a gardener or whatever, just being on planet Earth, basically because you have only two chances of eating either vegetarian or animal foods. Huh? So there is, whatever you do, however you try to exist, it will unintentionally have suffering as consequence for the other beings. So it's very difficult to be completely harmless. The only chance really in the ultimate sense is to go nirvana. There one is completely harmless, by definition. One doesn't incur any, the ego doesn't, that is not there in the first place, but the consciousness doesn't incur any damage to anybody at all, in the most ultimate sense. Then what about this offering flowers and so on? In general, I would say, there's these five spiritual abilities. Faith, satta, huh? Starts with faith, this is a little finger. This faith becomes confidence and then conviction when one experiences a state explained by the Buddha in extreme detail, that they are actually just so, tatata, and not otherwise. Then faith has become something else. It is not blind belief because one has personal, direct, personal experience confirming what the teacher has taught one, and thereby it is more than confidence, it is conviction now. One has proof of the pudding, inboard, doesn't need dependent upon books or teachers. One has direct personal experience. And I can recommend that you, as a principal, insist on that direct personal experience. As soon as you start that, and then you say, okay, I'll do whatever it takes for me to get this personal direct confirmation of the Dhamma, then I'll do it. Your path starts right there, plunk, if you stick with this principle. Because then eventually you will have direct personal experience of the phenomena of awakening, Bodhi, and of the state we call Nibbana. Direct personal experience has nothing to do with belief. How does you do that? That's these five abilities. Faith, the flower thing, is the first. The bowing down to the Buddha statue is the first. Then comes energy, enthusiasm, sitting on the pillow, going to meditation courses, listening to Buddhist videos, reading through Buddhist books. So this is the active part of faith. It's just the being examining, training, improving by repetitive reflection upon the Dhamma. Then this fruit leads to the next step, where there becomes awareness of internal states, good as bad, and awareness of external states, good as bad, and neutral as well. So awareness starts there. Then after awareness, concentration starts there, because when one is aware of one's own state, then one can concentrate. One can't develop on the pillow. One can't prevent distraction and going down the drain of disturbance, agitation, and mental noise. Unfortunately, I think it'll be too much to expect from my cat, who is in heat at the moment, and which I thought I have barred in up in the kuti, but somehow she escaped. Hey cat, is it possible that you can be silent? Huh? No? If you have to talk, you have to talk. Nevertheless, so again, the five spiritual abilities, the indriyas, faith, energy, enthusiasm, awareness, concentration, and then the real deal, understanding, wisdom, comprehension, panya. Satipatthana is panya. So I think it's better to go into a temple and meditate on the four establishment of mindfulness, seeing the body only as a form, seeing the feeling only as a reaction, seeing the mind only as a set of moods, and seeing all phenomena only as changing mental states. That is a higher praxis than giving flowers, whether fallen or not. It's a higher praxis, definitely. At the Buddha's time, there was no temples. There was no Buddha statues. This is basically a development of Buddhist culture. It is paraphernalia. It is something external to the training. It's a cultural phenomenon. It's a beginning. But it's definitely not the end. Neither is it a means to an end. But Satipatthana, establishment of awareness, is not only a beginning, it is the beginning, as the Buddha said, the Ikkayana Makko, the only and one direct way to the purification of beings. Again, establishing the fourfold awareness is the only single and unidirectional way to the purification of all beings, neither more nor less. So there you have it. I hope this answers these questions. Question 284, which is kind of like extension of that. How to avoid personality belief? Sakaya Ditchi. While paying respect in this way, using flowers, for example, or establishing mindfulness while doing meditation inside the temple. Yes. What's the flowers? This external physical state. A state of what? A state of form. Are they entities? No. Are they real? Yes, momentarily. Do they begin with mind? Yes, they do. They begin with what? Attention. Turn to the flowers. Then this visual form and color appears. Mind recognizes it and names it. So you have this naming and forming. In what way are they real? This is called the science of ontology in Western thinking, which is a science about in which way things exist. Yet if we take the prevailing thing, which is called atomism, and shred all flowers into atoms, and we can even stop with molecules fairly larger than sugar, which is two rings of carbon and hydrogen and nitrogen that is put together, little larger than that, or fairly much larger, up to molecular weight 9,000. If we take them and put them through a so-called double slit experiment, then all of them, and also those who are contained in the cat and in this so-called bag of bones and in this tree and in this mountain and in this entire universe, if we take any collection of atoms or molecules and put through this double slit experiment, then in between the slits of the double slit experiment I showed here on an illustration, and where they are observed, the so-called screen or detector, there they have only the properties of probability. They are only probabilities of being observed by a conscious observer. Are probabilities real? It's a semantic question, academic question. You can say when you throw the dice, there's 1/6, that is 17% chance of getting a sixer, and so also a one or a two or a three. This doesn't give us any knowledge about what will happen next time we throw the dice. But we can't say if we throw 6,000 times, then we get roughly 1,000 ones, twos, threes, fours, fives and sixes, roughly speaking. If we go to the moon, same thing happens. If we go to another galaxy where there's gravity, in 100 billion years or in 100 billion universal cycle, same thing happens. So I think you can ascribe some level of probabilistic reality to what happens to all these so-called real atoms that one early in former century thought was indestructible and everlasting. But as we now know from radioactivity, it's not the case. And from Buddhism, we have known always that they are blinking, basically. And they only have an atomic form and thereby a definite location, spin, or any macroscopic property whatsoever, if they are observed. And thereby, if they are under influence of consciousness. Their once belief in a self or a substance breaks down, because probabilities are something very invisible and is straddling in between the real and the unreal. if one sees him as information, I think it's a very good way of seeing it, because information always, there's always a knower of the information. And then when gets a very good modern handle on the ultimate reality in Buddhism, or the ultimate duality in Buddhism called Nama Rupa, can be translated as mind and matter. But since it's a dynamic thing, we'll call it minding and mattering. Directly translated means name and form. Naming and forming. Forming by designating, by turning attention to it and saying, ah, maybe there's a flower, pling, there's a flower. Same thing if you turn this probabilistic view in, internally, and then see, ah, there is this process of, now we are rid of the body. The body only is a bunch of probabilities, huh? There's no being or substance there. Then we look at the mental properties, the feelings of pain, pleasure, and neutral feeling, the perception of visual forms and color, sound, taste, touch, smell, and mental perception of ideas and mental states. We look at that. What is that? That's mental states, that's Dhamma. Whenever you try to look at it, then one very, very acute comprehension is very easy to see, and that is that it's something that comes and goes incessantly. If you look at me, my form will be different. Or at yourself, your form will be different from one moment to the next moment. Same thing with all other perceptions. Also with feelings, they change from 1 second to the next second. From 1 billionth of a second to the next billionth of a second. How can there be anything same? Or sameness? Or thereby identical with itself from one time frame to the next time frame? In there, in this incessant change, in this flux, in this process, there cannot be any entity, nor any identity, neither in there nor out there. If one sees that to the fullest extent, then there's no personality belief there, there's no Sakkaya Ditti. There's only impersonal, changing, fluxing states, whether physical or mental, whether internal, conventionally called mind, or externally, conventionally called others. But they come and go. You cannot keep them for a second. It's like the whistle in the forest. It's already gone. Try to keep this whistle. Try to keep it in existence. It's obviously impossible. It's gone. Even though we record it on a video, then it's just a repeat. It's not the real thing. It's not the event here under the tree. The 23rd March in the afternoon. So there is no being. There is no cat. There is this vocalization, this thinking, this experiencing emotions, feelings, this physical process of blinking states out there, probabilities manifesting themselves when they are exposed to a consciousness that itself is blinking. (5.6 × 10�43 times per second). That is more than 100,000 billion times per second. Are these mental states and these material states blinking? How can there be anything same in there? Of course there cannot be anything same. when one then disidentifies with this thing and disengages in that thing out there, the world, then craving fizzles out completely. Of course, pride and arrogance is evaporated long ago. So now one is floating like a balloon, not kept down by all this mental dirt. Then eventually, when this craving goes down, because one sees there's nothing to crave for, whatever there is cannot be kept, and it's not me nor mine in the first place. It's not what I am, what they are, what the world is. By the going down of craving, one sees a simultaneous going down of suffering. Because craving is the cause of suffering. When one experiences this reduction of suffering, of frustration, of confusion, of digging around, going nowhere in a ring, then one becomes reinforced by this is the path, because one understands, this understanding of this selflessness, of this substancelessness, anatta, no self, no substance, doctrine, particular to Buddhism. It is because of that that I'm detaching from all the external, and I'm disengaging from all internal. And by that, I feel lighter and lighter and lighter and lighter. Like a balloon. Like a balloon. And for this reason, this balloon, blooming mind, reason, this Dhamma on air will be called Dhamma on air number 95, the blooming mind. Thank you for your advantageous attention, your clever consideration, and your kind contribution. Thank you to all the food donors who gives food. I like to say one good way of learning generosity, if you like to give food to me or to others, to those who need it in Syria or wherever it's needed, or medicine or whatever is needed to Doctors Without Borders. It is, for example, whenever you go into the supermarket and buy some food, then you think by this, just once in a while, Benda also needs food. Now I buy food for myself, but then I can also give some food to others. As I'm giving Dhamma regularly by Benda, I'll also give back some food or whatever is needed to the Sangha. Thank you, and have a nice and beautiful, noble day. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Sammahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.